getting kind of push tap from Eli at NetSquared in Vancouver, and NetSquared is associated with TechSoup. So, and to get started is, you know, it's going to launch kind of a chapter to do that. So in other sort of cities around North America, there's kind of these sort of technology groups that clubs too. And so we're just kind of following suit. But launching a couple years ago, we had a lot of really positive response to it. So we're going to keep doing these lunch and learns and meetups using whenever. But they've all been great so far, and this is going to be another good one. So Tech4Good is, I'm Brett, Charlotte, a member, Sonia, and Aaron, and like I said, Holly, my instrument on the inside. So, without further ado, we have today's session will be on email, and we have Jasmin, whom I work with at rebel.com, and Charlotte at Bitworks. Rebel and Bitworks both sponsors and have been from the start. But you know, two great experts in the field for sure. So I'm going to hand it over to you guys now, and
you're live.
Before we get into that, I wanted to quickly touch on benchmarking, so figuring out where you are so that you know if what you're doing is successful or not successful. Those of you who are fundraisers in the room may have seen this. This is the MNR benchmark report, or my Bible. So MNR is an awesome organization out of the States. They take aggregate data from tens and tens of charities, big, small, different causes, and they create this series of benchmarks. So this is a great place to start if you're asking yourself, is what we're doing effective? At least you want to meet the leagues and ideally exceed them. But I often get asked, you know, what's a good industry benchmark? These guys are the best for you. So question one, how do we get people to open emails? The first thing is to get past spam filters. And this can be easier said than done depending on what you're doing, but it's one of those things that's often overlooked, I think. It's actually getting into that inbox first. So I wanted to quickly touch on it. It's not the end of your world, but it doesn't make a lot of sense to be sending email into the ether, basically, and not having it land. So some things you can do to maintain what's called a good sender reputation and to avoid getting dinged by with spam filters are to send email consistently. I know a lot of charities who send like 5 emails a year or like a ton of them on December 31st. You can't do, it sort of sticks out to a spam filter as like, oh, this guy's doing something kind of shady. If you send email more consistently, you're gonna get better placement in the inbox and you're gonna get into the inbox. Personalize wisely. If you use your first name in your emails, don't do that anymore. It's really common. It's also a huge red flag to spam filters. They will grab that so fast. So start looking at other ways to personalize more wisely. In this email, which is a kid's health phone email, we actually personalize based on gift amount. So where you can see these little dollar signs, that would have been their last gift and their last gift times two. So that's a different way to personalize that's not, hey, we know your first name, because I think all consumers and all donors know pretty quickly, you don't really know my first name. You didn't just handwrite me this email, this is a merge tag. Avoid color text in all caps, that's sort of a good link. We've all received these spam email that's like yelling at you. Don't do that, don't be that person. And keep a clean list. So have good list hygiene practices, be mindful of inactive subscribers, be clean with people who are bouncing. If you're sending to people who bounce a lot, it's gonna start to impact your sender reputation, you're gonna have a hard time getting past spam filters. Those would be some key things to take home, start implementing, they're easy things to do, and over time you're gonna see that they really, really benefit deliverability.
I would add to,
the
personalized wisely, that's not to say you can't use someone's name, but use it and maybe a different context instead of just your own to the body of the email, for example. So it's, you're still personalizing it and you're giving people that touch that makes it feel like you're actually thinking about that as a number or you know, a random donor. You don't do dear whatever, but still don't shy away from using your name.
I would suggest you put the first name beside the most important sentence in your email. We know that people love seeing your name, just like they love hearing your name. So like, put it in front of your call to action. It's like, Charlotte, don't you want to save a kid's life? Use it to pull by. Another thing is optimize send time. So this is a great thing if you want to do some split testing, is to spend some time figuring out what's the best time of day to send. The one sort of grain of salt I will say, and this is a great chart that shows it, I have a lot of people who stress very much about what day they're sending email. The larger your list is, the less of a difference that makes. Almost none when you get down to it. So it's really more about the time of day. So thinking about what a person's doing during that time of day. Are they commuting home so they can check their phone while they're on the train? Or maybe they can't because they're driving. Do they have kids? So maybe like 6 to 7 of bath time means bedtime. Thinking about sort of the day to day rather than in a week can be sort of a good decision.
Yeah. I agree with that. At Rebel, I have tried every different type of algorithm to get people to open emails. So I would be like, oh, you know, it's Friday afternoon, people have left work, or, you know, thinking that they would come home and read their email, and then they don't, and then I would try sending it on Saturday, and they didn't open it then. So this is a lot of trial and error. So my advice would be just try a bunch of different things and see what works. There's not going to be a one-size-fits-all for every company.
Yeah, every list is super unique. And stuff that works super well for some clients that I have does not work at all for others. So definitely test, even if you're taking learnings from a past organization and coming to a new one, do the same test you've done before and your friends really
time. Optimize your frequency. So as Charlotte was mentioning before, you don't want to send a bunch of emails right at the end of the year, but you also want to send enough so that you have a good sender score. But how do you know how much is too much? There are some recent stats that say 69% of users unsubscribe because they are receiving too many emails. So how do you know what is too many emails? Again, trial and error. I would suggest don't email people every single day. That is a way to make people unsubscribe really quickly. At Rebel, I try to send usually one a week, but that's generally because we have a bunch of different sales going on that I want people to know about. We still do get unsubscribes as well. Go ahead.
At what point would you sort of triage a list and say, these guys are really keen on what I've got to talk about, so I'll mail them every second day, and these guys once a week, and these guys twice a month? Do you do that when you get to a certain level?
Yeah, so I'd say once your list is a certain certain size, you can do that. We do something called automation, which we're going to talk about shortly, where I put people into different categories based on their behavior, like how they interact with an email or how much money they spend, for example. And then we send emails tailored to those people that speak more to how they're interacting with us. Yeah, so again, though, it's trial and error, but I would say maybe start with one a month, if that's realistic for you, and then either go up or down from there.
The other thing I would add, two things. There's sort of an ideal ratio, like fundraisers in the real, of three non-ask to one-ask emails. So especially if you're only sending 12 a year, your instinct is probably going to want to be only to send asks. I would really suggest that you increase that amount, but increase that amount to just straight up gratitude, authenticity, reporting back, thank you, and then send 12 appeals. Really augmenting that stewardship piece, we'll do one versus. Some of my best performing emails don't even have an ask, they don't even have a domain link. So people really respond to that. The other thing I will say is unsubscribes are not strictly a bad thing, and they don't mean you did something wrong. I know a lot of people see an unsubscribe and they're like, I've done something terrible and offended them. You haven't. It's like an amicable breakup. They're just sort of like, they were never going to give if they unsubscribed. So really, they've done you a favor. Now they're not spending your budget by making you send them emails that they were probably never going to open. They were probably suppressing all of your results. So in a way, when someone unsubscribes, if I've not seen like tons of unsubscribes, I'm like, thank you. I understand that we're no longer a good fit. So take that with a grain of salt and know that a good unsub rate is like 0.16%. So if you're seeing like a couple every email, that's really normal. I wouldn't worry.
Yeah, it's very normal. And honestly, I don't even read why people want to subscribe anymore, do you? Because often when you, like say you use a program like MailChimp, someone can write in why they want to subscribe. I just kind of stopped doing that.
They tend to get in the
book. Yeah, so you will just end up focusing on that one person that was really angry that day for whatever reason, and then you think that you're doing a really bad job, and that's just not the case.
Last but not least, the most obvious one, write an awesome subject line. And some of the things that you want to do instinctively here are not necessarily the best things. The thing that surprises the people that I talk to is that a longer subject line performs better. Your ballpark should be like 65 characters and not 6, which is what a lot of people go for. The reason is that when you go longer, you're managing expectations better. So you might have a slightly lower open rate, but you're getting people into the email who are expecting to be asked for money or who are expecting to be thanked. You're managing the expectation off the top, so you're getting more people in who are actually primed and ready to respond. So you're going to want to be honest with what's in that email. Tell them this is a newsletter. Tell them you can save a kid's life. Tell them what's in there, as opposed to just going for like the sort of intrigue creators, which can work a couple of times, but if you do them too often, people get wise very quickly. And also use your pre-header and preview text. I will see so often that people leave that blank, and that's just prime real estate in the inbox to augment your subject line with some more context. So I highly, highly recommend that you use them and you don't either delete them or leave them filled with dummy text, which breaks my heart every time it happens.
Yes.
So how do we get people to take action and click? The first thing I would say is a simple, clear ask. If you have more than one ask in your email, you have one ask too many. So this is an email from FCC where you can see there's just one ask in here. There's two opportunities to make it. I would have liked that button above the rule, but sometimes templates are a little more static than you want. But there only was one ask in here, and that's why it did well. It clearly said, this is why you should give, and now please give, and people do.
So, let me explain.
Jasmin's like, please use this out. Of
course. So, I wanted to talk about imagery in emails, and often people will use the worst stock photography just because it's free. Please don't do that, because stock photography is an immediate turn off. And people make fun of it. And this is an example. So recently on Twitter, this particular stock photo became a meme because it was so bad and everyone was making fun of it. And this is just a Simpsons version because I love the Simpsons, so that's why that's in there. But it's just to illustrate that people can spot really bad stock photography right away, and they'll just not take your message as seriously. And there are tons and tons of great free photo sites that you can use. At the end of this presentation, we have a link for you. There's sort of 74, 75 that we put together where you can find absolutely beautiful images that will stand out and not look ridiculous. So that's really what I wanted to say here. Please don't use bad stock photos.
Yes. Speaking of using free photography, I have two questions around that, and maybe you'll get to this. One is, how do I know for sure that this is something that's out there that I can use for free? And the other thing is, what is your standard of
A lot of the sites that we use, one of the ones that I use every day is called pexels.com. It'll be in the list that we provide. But it explicitly use them as you like. However, you are welcome to credit the photographer if you want, but the photographer has submitted those images to that website as a way to just get exposure for their photos. So you do not have to credit them. If you have grabbed an image just off of Google image search, which I highly recommend not doing, you would want to credit where you got it from, but you're really opening a can of worms there that could lead to you getting in trouble from, say, iStock, I think, is that one of the big ones?
They will find you.
They will find you. Your email or your blog post or whatever you're using in could be years old, and they will find you and ask that you pay them. So I would say avoid that completely and just go with some of these free ones where it's
Yes.
Yes. Go to the specific website. Don't use Google image search. It will get you in trouble.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Segmenting your audience. So this is something that I do every day, so I can deliver more impactful emails. So by segmenting, I mean based on activity. So let's say you have donors that are donating X amount of money and up, or they've only donated once and you maybe want to get them to donate again. You're not going to send the same email to all of those people. What you want to do is segment it based on their activity with you so that you can give them an email that will most likely make them act. So if they've only donated once, say at Christmas time, because they wanted to get their tax refund, you could send those people a very specific email that says something like, hey, thank you very much for your donation. If you become a monthly donor, this is what you will get. And I have found that at Rebel, by doing this, it actually really increases the open rates and click-throughs. So if you have this kind of information, you need to do this. Just sending blanket emails does not work. I have tried it. People just become inbox blind because the stuff that you're sending them just doesn't apply to them. So they just immediately delete it or put it in a spam.
And you can also, I think, from like a database point of view, you can segment based on giving behavior, giving frequency. You can segment it or lapse people and try to reactivate them. You can even, if you're sending, if you're doing a digital campaign, you can send specific emails to people who clicked on the email but didn't give yet. And that is a really, really great way to sort of increase what those people are. You can sort of raise their hands and I'm sort of interested, they might just need that reminder. Yeah. So yeah, Jasmin's totally right when she says segmentation is a great way to capitalize on what you have as opposed to trying to get more.
Yeah. I mean, that's not to say you can't send in like an email, you know, once a year or something you would like, but it's just in order to get that increased conversion rate, sending something that's very personal that a user feels like you wrote it just for them is the best way to get people to actually take an action.
If you're doing an email campaign and you've got scheduled like multiple emails, would you not, if someone didn't open the first one, would you exclude them from the second round?
I would. It would depend on the size of the campaign that I was doing. I would sort of exclude them going forward, but I might pull out my people who clicked, my people who opened, and people who didn't respond yet, and give them some different messaging. Folks who didn't open, I
addresses that question, and you can create a flow sort of how someone would move through those different emails that you've set up based on activities they've taken. So we can just explain that a little bit.
So question three, how do we know if it's working? The first thing I would recommend you do if you haven't already is integrate with Google Analytics. Most email clients or email service providers will do this. It's an awesome way to track who you drove, where you drove them, and what they did when they got there, especially if you can get some cross-domain tracking in place. And it's just really, really useful right off the bat to be able to say, you know, I sent this email and I increased traffic by 50%. I sent this email and I generated $500,000 in revenue. Can get you some easy buy-in for more investment into email, and it's free. Google Analytics is free, so there's no reason not to, right?
There's also, depending on what email service provider you use, although I would imagine most of them have this, they already have built-in stats that you can use that will show you how many people clicked, the email address of those people that clicked, who has not opened your past 5 emails, those kind of stats. You can also integrate most email service providers with some of the donation things that you were mentioning. I don't know what they are off the top of my head, but like Shopify, for example. And then that will give you some even more in-depth stats of how much someone is spending or donating. And using that in concert with Google Analytics is probably your best bet.
And if you use an email service provider that doesn't organically integrate with your shopping cart or your payment processor, there's always the option of APIs if you have the money to spend and some post code for you. Most of them are pretty open to that. So you don't ever have to discount it because there's not an easy way to do it. There's probably a way to do it.
Yes.
What was an API? Right, what does API stand for?
Application Programming Interface. So, what it does, though, it's a way for machine computers to talk to each other. So with some programming, you can either add some information to the analytics or read some information off of your email, provide them. So you can cross-reference. It's a way to cross-reference.
Thanks,
Tech4Good.
Last but not least, how do we improve on getting better and get more out of our inboxes?
So split testing, also called A/B testing, this is a great way to find out what works and what doesn't with your audience. I don't know if it's on the next slide or not, but this is really good to do when you have, say, 1,000 or more subscribers. Anything below that, your results are not going to be very statistically good.
Yeah, you want 500 people per variant that you're testing in order to get statistical significance, which I recognize can be hard if you have a small list. Doesn't mean you shouldn't test because it's usually free to do, but you just want to take those learnings with a grain of salt and keep in mind, okay, I want to make sure I retest this later once my list is done.
Exactly. And you can really test anything. So it could be your subject line, it could be the image that you use, it could be whether you put the person's name, you know, in the body of the email, or maybe even in the subject line of the email. There's tons of different ways, almost an infinite amount of ways that you can test what your subscribers will respond to. And even, just as an aside, I do this with Rebel all the time, and even though our list is quite large, I still don't always get statistically, blowing me away stats. Like sometimes the A/B test will be 1% difference in something, and try to learn from that. So it's again a lot of trial and error. This is the thing with emails, everything's trial and error, really.
Yeah.
There is no set way to do anything. It's just keep trying and find what works for you.
And I would also say don't shy away from repeating tests. I know a lot of people are like, oh, we tested our send time and we know it now. Test send time like 10 times in 2 months. And then figure out, take all of those results and aggregate them, and maybe you'll get some more clear information. If you just test these things one time, you may find this is sort of a fluke, it's actually not the most accurate thing.
Exactly.
So I'm going to keep it going. What else can you do to improve? You can go mobile. if your email is not mobile responsive, you're making a huge mistake. We know that year over year, traffic is growing globally. Every single client I have has more than 60% of their people reading their emails online. And that includes people, that includes clients for whom their donor base is skewed older, like 65, 75, 85.
When you send out online, you mean on a phone?
Yeah, sorry, on a phone. So even like, or on a tablet, any mobile device. So that means you're gonna wanna have an email template that's mobile responsive. Not just that, but you're gonna wanna have a donor journey that's mobile responsive. So if you have a mobile optimized template in your email that you're sending people to a donation page that's unusable on mobile, there's almost no point in sending that email because you're asking people to take an action that they literally cannot take. So the next step, especially if you've got that mobile optimized template, is, you know, try giving a gift. Next time you send an email, make sure it goes to you and try giving a gift from a couple of different smartphones, from your tablet, from different OSs, and try to get that experience and see, okay, where are the barriers? Where is this frustrating to me? Because that's where you're losing people right off the top. It'd be a huge recommendation for me is if you guys are not mobile, be that way. And most email service providers make that free and available to you, so it's easier than ever. You don't need custom code to do it.
So this is the automation part that I've been alluding to. So, for lack of a better phrase, set it and forget it. But don't really forget it. You need to be looking at it all the time and seeing how things are going. But essentially what it is you're creating something that's similar to emails that will be triggered based on how the first email went. So you'll create a path that starts with an activity among the donor. They will receive this first email. Then, depending on what they do with that email, they will move down the path and they'll receive another email from you that will say something like, hey, we saw that you clicked on the email, but you didn't actually follow through with making a donation. Here is all the good things that your donation will do. And then, based on your activity in that email, they'll move to the next step. So, it's essentially allows you to be a little bit hands-off and just kind of get people moving through the system. This is, I wouldn't say that it's a relatively new thing, but a lot of businesses are just kind of starting to do this now. At Rebel, we just started doing it this year, and we're still learning about what's the best way to do it. I don't know necessarily if this applies to people who work in the nonprofit space, but businesses that have started using it after 1 year said that they saw 32% in increased revenue and then 40% going on after that. So it is a bit of a slow burn, but honestly, it's made my life a lot easier being able to just send emails to people based on actions that they take on our website without me having to even think about it. The initial setup is a bit of work, but once it's up and running, it's really just monitoring it and optimizing it. Not all email service providers give you an automation option. We had to actually switch email service providers in order to get this. But if it's something that you think would benefit you to make your life easier, I would highly recommend trying this. But don't be discouraged if it doesn't work right away, because it takes a little bit.
I would also have retention, which 99.9% of charities I work with do. Automation can be a huge boon for you to keep donors and foster donors, because we know that only 21% of the donors that you acquire online are going to stay with you, which is pretty useful. But if you can use automation to welcome people, to start reporting back right away, to upgrade them to a one-time gift or a monthly gift. Three or four email welcome series are really, really common and can be really effective at someone who subscribes as a supporter to become a donor, someone who becomes a one-time donor, convert them to monthly. These are great tools to do that can really help ease those retention pains that are super, super common and will get you a better ROI, because we know how much more expensive, between 5 to 10 times more expensive to get a new donor than to work with one that you already have. So as soon as someone raises their hand, start telling them about how great you are. And how great they are, importantly.
your list if you are looking to get more people to actually sign up for your email. So if you have a subscription-based service, like we do at Rebel, that's how we get most of our people on our email list. So once they have become a customer, they're on our email list, unless they unsubscribe. But if I want to get some more highly qualified leads, say from Twitter, for example, I would send people to a landing page that had a very clear and honest reason about why they should sign up for us, for our emails, what they're going to get from us for signing up. On those sign-up pages, don't say things like, we promise we won't send you a spam. I see this a lot, and the reason that I say don't say that is because as soon as you say the word spam, it's in bad sense that you're going to send them spam. Even though you explicitly said, I'm not going to send you spam, they're immediately associating you with spam, and they will not want to sign up. I know it sounds crazy, but it's true. And then finally, offer quality gated content. And gated content, for those that don't know, is, say, a white paper that someone needs to provide their email address in order to download it. So if you would like to get someone's email address by providing them with something, it needs to be something that is relevant, that has information that will actually help them, not just like a sales pitch.
Last but not least, we wanted to leave you with some handy resources, and I will send a deck around to those of you who are awesome. So don't worry about writing all of that down. It's all hyperlinked. But that's about it for us. Thank you guys for listening. And if you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them now, or just shoot us an email if that's helpful to you as well.
In terms of getting your email open, how important would you say the from field is, and like that being a person, and
the best practice is typically person plus board name. So, you know, I am Allison Trammell from Good Works. It creates that sort of marriage of feeling very personal while creating the familiarity, the recognition of the organization name. So that's typically what I suggest clients do. Some people play with other things, especially if you have a from name or a sender who's really commonly used. You can try just the front name of just the person's name. Person's name plus board name.
That's something you can split test too.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm Catherine, I work at Enterprise, and my I'm a fundraiser primarily, and I'm curious to know sort of how bad of a situation I'm in. So our database is not synced with our e-list. So we have two separate systems, and I want to know who else. Or just how, like, so I'm thinking about this API, I think, but because so many of these options, like, so many of the ways to improve it to use the list, the email service provided better, really depends on what information you get, and I can't get my donor information from my constant contact email provider. So, is anyone else a fundraiser who has separate systems? Am I alone?
Okay. I have a lot of clients who do.
Yeah.
And there's sort of two ways around this. So one is to use automation based on their behavior within the email client. So you still have the ability to automate based on how many clicks for those pieces.
Yeah.
And then I have a lot of clients who straight up just pull fresh lists and populate them regularly.
Yeah.
It's not ideal, although it can give you, you know, the most up-to-date data, especially if you're a little bit worried about any hassle. Weirdness,
yeah.
But I do go out clients who just straight up pull fresh lists and send them, and is it a little more work? Sure. Is it enough of an ROI boost to make it worth it?
Yeah.
Okay. And know that you're not alone, you're not like, you know, committed email send. It's super, super common.
Thank you.
When you say pull fresh lists, we are on the razor's edge, you know exactly who they want to send that email to, and they'll pull those people out and upload that list into your email client and send to those people.
So how do you
If someone's unsubscribed and you're using an email client, your email client will know that they've unsubbed and they have. That's why you should never want to delete someone out of MailChimp, once your contact, what have you. That subscriber history is really important. It helps to avoid duplication, helps to avoid any subscribe issues. So pull the list you must subscribe after the email sends, and you can talk with the updated database if you want to be like super diligent.
I just don't want to send people emails that they ask not to get.
I agree. Yeah. And it's honest, it's like it's harder and harder to do in some ways because you know you can pull out that list of people who don't want to give and make sure that you don't. You can make sure that you're using an email client that will pull those people out. So you're probably in the safest place you've ever been to not be doing that.
I have two questions. The first regarding the use of imagery that's in use. So we will pull images from these websites. So is that okay as long as we credit the photographer who was?
It ends up not being okay.
Do you think they're word out lawyers?
Yeah.
can I jump in on that one?
Yeah.
I think your answer should be no. Until say yes. So copyright isn't used until you. Copyright should be you need to get explicit usage to use photos. Okay. So if you don't have explicit license to use that photo, then it's a no by default.
Yeah.
So a news site you can't down. So you can't use any photos unless it says that you can use it. So taken from news sites is would be copyright infringement.
Okay.
Yeah, even crediting it, it's because you didn't pay for the image.
Yeah.
What kind of images do you like? Do you want like a current image of say like a Justin Trudeau or something?
Yeah.
Like, oh, okay. And you can getting an image like that is difficult without paying.
Okay.
Is there a way for you to use an image that is not?
Well, because so like for example, like if a minister releases like had a press conference regarding a new decision.
Right.
Like the only way to show that would be
to
use
that image,
that
right?
Yeah, so you can stop for it.
It would probably be worth it. I don't know if this is this, so if it does and you already know this, you'll literally. I know that a fair number of newspapers, like The Citizen, for example, will have policy on that kind of licensing, and for all I know, the government of Canada does too. It would be worth doing a bit of research and seeing, like, it's totally possible that any government of Canada photography is creating comments that open license for free media.
Yeah.
So it might already be that you're actually in totally safe waters.
Okay.
And you're not super likely gifting, it's just that when you're gifting, it can be super excessive. I didn't have a client who once had to pay $10,000. Not when I worked with them, but once I paid $10,000 for a software that they accidentally used. Don't let that happen to you. That's what I meant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I agree that I'm not lawyers, but I feel like it might be a Creative Commons thing where you, because it's in the interest of the public, that you may be able to use those images, but that's all of the
And my second question was, so we have a lot of webinars, and we found that sending reminders helps increase number of registration webinars, but there's a certain point where people start unsubscribing because you're sending too many reminders. I don't have an idea of what's
How many reminders would you say that you send?
So we usually do the announcement about 2 to 3 weeks before, and we'll send about 3 of them.
I would say that's reasonable. I mean, that's like you're almost sending one a week as a reminder. I think that's completely reasonable, and like we had mentioned, there's people that are going to unsubscribe anyway, and they were already not really interested or engaged with what you had to say.
Okay.
So losing that person in the end is not really that big of a deal. I would say that frequency is totally fine.
Okay.
Don't increase it though. That might be getting into a bit of a too much territory, but once a week is.
Is the content different in every reminder? Or is it the same email sent 3 times?
It's actually the same email.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with sending the same email twice in a row. I have often done that. An easy win for you can easily be take and peel, send it to the people who clicked but didn't give, and add a reminder to the subject line.
Mm-hmm.
You get the order, you're like, oh yeah, I'm starting to think about it, just shoot that reminder to you, that's a super easy win. But then maybe that's your issue. I agree, Jasmin, I think you're probably saying that those people are probably just your natural churn, which everyone's going to see, and your churn rate should be like 7%-ish, plus people who subscribe or bounce, and as long as you have enough people coming in to offset that, I won't worry about it.
I just want to go back to the images. If you're on Google Images and you do a search, you can actually filter by rights.
Yep.
But is that trustworthy? Or you shouldn't trust that.
I personally don't. I always use sites like Pexels is a great one, Unsplash, Negative Space. I almost exclusively, if I'm going to use job photography that it's free, I will almost always just use those databases for safety. You can go with the Creative Commons way, there's nothing wrong with it, especially if you search through the Creative Commons database rather than Google. There's also the requirement to attribute if you're using Creative Commons photography rather than using it from a free database. You don't have to, it's an option.
Yeah.
So there's that to keep in mind if you don't want to have the attribution in your email.
I would caution against using Google for images at all, even if it seems like it's okay. It's risky. So, but that free stock photography aggregate, there's like 75 or something on there, and honestly, they're beautiful, and you will find the picture that you need for your emails for sure.
All of the stock that we used in this was free stock photography. If that gives you an idea of the quality you can search for. I just searched for computer.
That's literally what I searched for. Computer.
Focus. I totally support sending blog posts, absolutely. It's all about framing them correctly.
coming up, Tech4Good, we have a great session coming up September 20th. So we have storytelling. Hasn't quite hit the presses yet, but we're going to start bringing that out this week. It's going to be on storytelling. We're going to have Ryan Davies from Carleton University and Scott Annan from Foundings.io, possibly another speaker. I'll have on storytelling. It's going to be an evening event. There'll be some networking, probably some beverages. It'll be fun. After that, we have a hackathon. It's called Random Hacks of Kindness. Cash has been a part of that in the past, and Omar, have you been a part of it? So it's a hackathon for social good, and we do it twice a year. And what we do is, again, in the same sort of vein of tenting, digital and technology folks with nonprofits, we'll have six or seven challenges nonprofits that have brought forward, and it'll be a technology challenge, or a challenge that can be solved by, you know, a bit of code or design thinking or something that's kind of web-related or app-related. And we'll bring about 75 developers and to work on those challenges. Going to our seventh event, so it's going to be October 13th, 14th, 15th. It's a whole weekend. It's going to be at the Adobe building in Preston. It's going to be great. We did our last one in March, and always get really great feedback from it. And sometimes projects even launch. Alex is a veteran of hackathons and all that, for sure. And it's one of the demos.
It's all for good.
Anyway, so that, you can find out more information there at rhok.ca, or just visit us on Twitter or email. Thanks to our sponsors. Rebel is a sponsor. BigWorks is a sponsor. Industrial Agency, they're a design development agency in Westboro. And then NetSquare and N10, they help fund this a little bit. And they're both, like I said earlier, the kind of North American hub for all these. Anyways, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.